It's hard to believe that just over 100 years ago, the children of this quaint village sparked what went on to become the longest-running strike in history. I'll reveal why they rebelled and, indeed, where I am in just a few moments. On today's search, a couple of passionate buyers who aren't shy of showing their emotions.
Tick.
Oh my gosh!
And I'm determined to blow them away with the very best properties.
Wow. Absolutely wow.
So far, so wow.
Yes.
Today I'm in Norfolk, and this is the Burston Strike School, the alternative establishment built for the children of this village after they refused to attend their original school when their teachers were dismissed. Now, it started back in 1914, when those school children protest marched around this village demanding the reinstatement of those teachers. Today, the building is a museum, a monument to that protest. But I'm pleased to say the peace now reigns throughout Burston, as it does through all the charming villages that this beautiful county has to offer. Norfolk lies on England's east coast, and with its neighbouring counties of Suffolk, Cambridgeshire and Essex, makes up part of East Anglia, one of Britain's key farming regions where three-quarters of the land is used for agriculture. Norfolk itself is perhaps best known for its man-made broads, 125 miles of meandering lock-free waterways which were given national park status in 2015. Head north across the patchwork of fields and you'll find a striking and varied coastline, home to some of the UK's most unspoiled beaches, including Wells Next to Sea and Holcombe. Hunstanton is home to the distinctive 59 feet high red and white chalk cliffs, where visitors are drawn in search of fossils or to enjoy the rock pools on the beach below. The county has plenty to explore inland too. There's the largest concentration of medieval churches in the world and a wealth of stately homes like Houghton Hall, built in 1720 for Britain's first Prime Minister, Sir Robert Walpole. With all this and a reputation for being the driest county in England, Norfolk is the perfect escape destination for all seasons. When it comes to buying a country home in Norfolk, the average price of a detached house is around £295,000, which is pretty good value when you consider that that's £40,000 below the national average. Naturally, that price increases in the county's more desirable areas, like the Broads and along its north coast. But if you're prepared to explore further inland, then you might just pick yourself up a bargain. So, if you're looking for the all-important, life-changing move, then Norfolk could be the county for you, which is just as well, as that's exactly what today's buyers are looking to do.
Newlyweds Luke, who manages a cheese shop and cafe, and Charlotte, who shares his passion for fine food and drink, have lived together in Greenwich in southeast London for 3 years. But it was another interest that first brought them together.
We met at a music festival in King's Cross in London. How long ago was it?
We met 5 years ago. I went to go and get some beers and a gorgeous, tall, blonde-haired chap turned round and said, "Hi, I'm Luke." And I thought he was gorgeous.
Yeah.
And it was definitely the best festival I've ever been to in my life.
Although they've enjoyed the excitement of city life, in the last couple of years, their priorities have changed due to the arrival of daughter Dolores.
Dolores is 20 months old. She is a bit of a character. She's very funny, makes us laugh a lot, always on the go.
We, you know, kind of feel now that we'd like her to have a lot more space, a lot more freedom to run around, and in London, you just don't get that, and it's very, very urban.
Charlotte is originally from Oxford, and Luke was born and bred in rural Hertfordshire. A childhood in the countryside is something he's keen to replicate for Dolores.
I grew up on a farm, so we had loads of space. Summer holidays were amazing. We just spent them outdoors the whole time. And we had so much freedom to explore that's one of the reasons why I want to move back out, because I can't imagine Dolores growing up and not having as much freedom as that.
The couple love to socialise, but with limited space in their three-bed Victorian house, most of their entertaining happens in their converted summer house. They hope a move to the countryside will afford them a better quality of life, but also more room to welcome family and friends. With their sights set on the Norfolk-Suffolk borders, they'll still be within 2 hours from the big smoke.
I will miss great places to eat and drink.
I think I miss the diversity of people that we have here. I think it makes life very interesting, but I'm sure we'll find some characters in village life as well.
We quite like the idea of being sort of in a village where they do have some amenities, mm-hmm. you know, shop, pub. That'd probably be enough for us, wouldn't it?
For the foreseeable future, Luke will need to commute to London, but he and Charlotte are keen to strike a work-life balance, meaning their family can make the most of the outdoor lifestyle on offer in Norfolk.
We are looking forward to just spending so much more time together and out in open fresh air, really, because another thing you don't get in London is fresh air.
We're still going to have commitments in London, but I think long-term we see ourselves as being based in Norfolk and making our lives in Norfolk and making that work. I think that's the ultimate goal.
Absolutely.
To keep journey times to London to a minimum, Luke and Charlotte would like to search in the south of the county and are also open to seeing houses in neighbouring Suffolk. I'm meeting them close to the county border to run through their wish list.
So, a bit of a drive to the countryside. Looks like it was worth it, wasn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's great.
It's all about a better quality of life coming out here, isn't it?
Definitely. That's exactly why we're coming here.
So, let's talk about the house. First and foremost, what are we looking for?
I mean, we like period properties, older properties, but we're quite easygoing. You know, anything that we think there's potential there to make it a home.
We like to live outdoors, you know. In the summer, we love to have barbecues, we have lots of parties. We've actually got a bar at the bottom of our garden as well. So, yes, we'd like to
replicate
that.
Potential for al fresco dining and drinking.
Yeah. Yes.
OK. Size of house. How big does it need to be?
Three bedrooms, or four we're looking for, aren't we?
Yes. I'd like four, but three is the absolute minimum.
And downstairs, you sound like quite a social couple, so I imagine the kitchen living areas, they're pretty important to you.
Yeah, definitely. Very important. We pretty much live in the kitchen and the dining room.
Right, OK. What about neighbours? How close can neighbours be?
I think ideally we would like some space around us.
Yeah.
But
so we're detached at the moment, but we still have neighbours all around us, so it would be nice to sort of not be able to see in our garden, you know.
What about the whole detached thing?
Yeah, it'd be ideal, wouldn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
It's not.
It would be ideal, not necessarily. I heard absolutely here.
Yes.
All wrapped in a budget of how much?
Around 400,000.
Around £400,000. Mm. Okay. You ready to get going?
Absolutely.
Just this way. Yep.
So for their £400,000 budget, Charlotte and Luke would like a detached property with some character and a minimum of three bedrooms. Entertaining space is vital, both inside and out, so we're looking for somewhere with a large kitchen and garden. We've got three properties to show them, all of which have the potential to be transformed into a great family home. But they won't find out the price tag of each one until the end of their tour. Finally, we'll be straying away from their wish list with our mystery house, which could give them just what they're looking for, but in a different form.
So how long have you been in your current house?
3 years.
Who made the decision on the last property you bought?
We both loved it
straight away.
So are you hoping that's going to happen again this time? Walk through the door, yes, this is us.
Yeah. We're very impulsive and emotional and passionate buyers. So,
are you? OK.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's good. So I'll know pretty much straight away if it's going well or not.
Yeah.
That's good and bad.
I know.
We're starting our search right on the Norfolk-Suffolk border in the small semi-rural village of Toft Monks. The nearest amenities are 5 miles away in the market town of Beccles. Perched on a hill overlooking the Waveney Valley, the town is known as the gateway to the Southern Broads. Its streets are lined with quirky, independent shops and cafes. And something I think will really appeal to our buyers are the regular markets held here. Plenty of opportunity for our foodies to find some great local produce. Back in Toft Monks, our first property is in a quiet cul-de-sac.
Now, along this drive, there are three houses. This one could be yours.
Ooh! Looks big.
Mm. Yeah.
Yes, unusual, isn't it?
And I can see lots of ducks around, so...
Well, you have shared responsibility for this duck pond.
Wow!
With that neighbour.
OK.
Wow, that's really cool, yeah.
So the house itself, what do we think?
Well, I know what you're going to say, first of all, solar panels.
Yeah, I'm not a massive fan of solar panels.
But I am, because I'm all about saving the environment.
And saving money?
Yes.
Ready to go inside?
Wonderful, yeah.
Come on.
This detached house was built in the 1990s, but through the clever use of some old materials, has some nice character inside. The front entrance leads us straight into what is, for these two, the most important part of the house.
Righty-ho, first room.
Oh, my goodness. Mm. This is massive.
It's nice.
Mm.
This is entertaining space.
Yeah, exactly what you said you're after, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
You've got a really handy utility through that door.
Brilliant.
With a ground floor loo beyond. And then here, I thought, well, that's perfect for you and the young family. That's the kids' playroom.
Yeah.
Yeah, with the doors.
Doors straight out to the garden.
That's nice.
It's a great size.
Isn't it?
Yeah, I love the beams as well. And I mean, the actual kitchen isn't necessarily to our taste, but we're not afraid to sort of, you know, move things about and jiggle things. But I think you just need to have that space in the first place.
It's a good layout, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so. You spend most of your time in the kitchen, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
A time to relax, perhaps in the living room. Let's go and take a look.
Okay,
proportions shrink somewhat in here.
Okay.
You can see it just through there. They don't use very much, admittedly.
I don't think it's a bad size. I mean, it's probably twice the size of our living room in London at the moment. So.
Yeah. So is this what you expected to be looking at so far? And this is your first physical viewing?
I think it's a little more modern than I expected.
Okay.
A little bit less sort of oldie-worldy than I was expecting, yeah.
Okay.
I think, you know, as long as you've got a bit of imagination, you can make anything work. But, you know, it's just whether or not this is the right property for us.
One of three, isn't it? Let's go and take a look upstairs, show you what we've got in the way of bedrooms.
Okay.
It's great that Luke and Charlotte are thinking practically about this house, but I'm not sensing any passion punching through yet. Upstairs, a large, bright landing leads to four well-proportioned bedrooms, including one fitted out as a study and a huge family bathroom.
OK, so the main bedroom is this one.
Lovely.
Ensuite.
Yes.
Mm.
Very good.
Nice.
It's a nice size, isn't it?
Good size, yeah. No complaints about size.
Yeah. And so far, I can just see green outside, which is
lovely,
also
yeah.
good.
Very light, isn't it, with all the windows? It's a lot of light coming through, which is quite nice.
Yes, because we're used to sort of Victorian small windows, so that's obviously a nice change.
So far, so good. Yeah, tentatively,
yeah.
Okay, quite good.
No, so far, so good, yes. Yeah,
all right, yeah. Outside space.
Yes.
At the top of your list, isn't it? Let me just squeeze through.
Okay.
We'll head out to the garden.
To the front of the property, there's a garage, and to the back, a large entertaining area, a vegetable patch, and a small enclosed garden. But the main lawn area stretches down the side of the property and is where I imagine the family would spend most of their time.
What's your thoughts?
I think it's a bit exposed, I would probably say.
That's it.
To your neighbours that side?
Yeah, I'd like that higher hedge there.
So okay.
More privacy, I think.
Obviously, that's easily changeable.
Mm-hmm.
It's a decent enough size. I think there's plenty of, you know, room to kind of zone the areas out.
Yeah. OK, so how much do you think this house is on the market for?
I would probably say £325,000.
Right, OK.
I'm going to say a little bit more. I think £340,000.
You're both quite a bit out.
Wow.
Okay. This has just been reduced to offers in excess of £375,000.
OK, OK.
Yeah.
But, well, this is time for you to go back in the house and have a look around on your own, all right?
Yeah.
See you in a bit.
Thanks all very right. much,
Thank
Charlotte.
You.
Cheers.
Right.
Bye.
coming in £25,000 under budget, this detached four-bedroom, two-bathroom home offers plenty of space for a growing family and for entertaining. All in a peaceful setting, just 5 miles from the nearest town.
This would be quite a nice area to have as, like, the adults area, wouldn't it?
It would.
We could have Rum Shack Part 2 over there.
Grow the hedges a little bit taller.
Yeah, and at least it's away from anybody's washing, or even our washing.
Yeah.
If we want to do some hardcore barbecuing one day.
Yeah.
As soon as I walked in, I was absolutely astounded by the size of the kitchen and really excited by that. To see such a warm welcome when we walked through the door was wonderful.
I think, for me, something about the feel of the house just doesn't feel quite right. I really like the size of the rooms, but I do think that we would have to do quite a bit of work to the house. And it's just whether we're prepared to spend that extra money getting it to look exactly how we want it to look.
I've been out here ages! How'd you get on?
It was great. It's a good start, isn't it?
Yeah.
A good start.
Yeah, I think it's a good start. It doesn't feel like it's for you.
No.
But I'm figuring out in my mind other houses that could be.
Yeah, absolutely. We're really excited to see what else you've got for
Come
us.
Come on, then.
All right, then.
Norfolk's rich arable landscape and fertile terrain make it perfect for crop production. One crop which thrives in the region is barley, used by some 50 breweries in the county to make beer. Keen to find out more about artisan business opportunities for when they make the move to Norfolk, we've sent Luke and Charlotte to visit a local microbrewery. Phil Hall has been brewing in the barns of an old dairy just outside Arbroath for 11 years. Using locally sourced produce, he and his business partner make 500,000 pints of cask and keg beer each year.
Welcome to Grain Brewery.
Thank you so much. Tell us, how did you get started?
Well, it was about 10 years ago that I was doing a job that I enjoyed, but I kind of wanted to get out from under the desk. I wanted to do something more hands-on. And then my good friend Jeff, who was already involved in the brewing industry, he could see that things were starting to change. A lot of the dull beers were around, weren't very popular. There's a few new breweries popping up around the place. So he came to me and said, why don't we start a microbrewery? And I thought, why don't we do it? Let's give it a go.
How do you stand out in the market?
Well, we're producing beers that other brewers around us aren't producing. One of our beers, for example, is a Weissen. It's an authentic Belgian-style wheat beer with orange peel and coriander. As far as I know, we're the only brewery in East Anglia who produces a true-to-style wheat beer like that.
So can I have a look at how you do it?
Absolutely. Well, we're about to start brewing our Weissen, so if you follow me, we'll go and have a look.
In 2002, the government introduced the Small Brewers Relief, enabling new businesses like this one to get off the ground by paying just half the beer duty of a large brewery. A resurgence of craft beers then followed. After saving up £50,000 and investing in some second-hand equipment, Phil and Jeff were brewing in less than a year. And inspired by their love of continental beers, they soon began to experiment with foreign styles, like their Weissen.
So this is the brew house. This is the engine room of the brewery and where the magic happens.
What's the first step when it comes to making beer?
Well, the first thing that happens is we get the malted barley down there, we mix it up with the hot water, it falls down into here, spray ball at the top there, and that's where we get the colours and the flavours and the sugar out of the malted barley. And it's going to be sitting in there for an hour before it then moves on to the next stage, where we pump it into the copper here, and that's where we add the hops and also the orange peel and coriander. And then at the end of the day, it moves on right down there into the fermentation room where we add the yeast, and the yeast eats up the sugar and turns it into alcohol.
Coriander seems like a strange flavour. Can you add anything to a beer?
You can add whatever you want to a beer. People add all sorts of different fruits. It's worth experimenting.
How would I go about starting?
Well, the best thing to do is just go out there and give it a go. You can go to a shop and buy a homebrew kit, which will give you some malt syrup, and then boil it up in a saucepan at home. You can get a plastic bucket fermenter where you add the yeast and you can produce beer.
So can we see how it's done then?
Of course you can. So let's get started.
Yeah, OK.
The process of producing beer takes anywhere from a couple of weeks to a couple of months. A day in the brewing house is followed by up to 2 weeks in the fermentation tanks, depending on the strength of the beer, before it's left to mature. The brewery currently ships around 10,000 pints a week to local pubs and shops across Norfolk and Suffolk. In 2017 alone, their beers have won 6 national and 9 regional awards. But will they pass Luke and Charlotte's taste test?
Well, here you are. This is the Weissen that you brewed, helped brew next door. Give it a try. Tell me what you think.
That's lovely, Phil. Not too sweet, nice and crisp. Loads of flavour, really fresh, floral. That's delicious.
That's all right. Really summery. Goodness for that. Good.
Yeah.
That's great news.
This would be really interesting to pair with some cheese, actually, Phil. I think it could work really well with a fresh goat's cheese.
Well, I'm more of a beer expert than I am a cheese expert, but I do know that for a beer with it, you've got lots of flavour going on in there. So what you really want is a full-flavoured cheese, something like a Stilton, to balance out the flavour in the Weissen.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you're right. I think that'd be a good combination.
Well, the local beer has got Luke's seal of approval. Let's hope our next property will too. For our second offering, we're heading into the heart of Norfolk to the hamlet of Westfield. It's 3 miles from the thriving market town of Dereham. With a population of around 16,000, it's one of Norfolk's largest towns and has a wide range of amenities serving the residents and those in the surrounding villages. The property we're seeing is in a rural spot back in Westfield.
So we're gradually going back in time. This house number 2 is built around 1840.
Wow. Absolutely wow.
Good wow.
Good wow, yeah.
I had to check.
Love the setting. The house looks big. Yeah, this is everything that I imagined. I'm very excited.
Excellent. What do you think of it, Lee?
It looks lovely. It was straight away drawn to the garden. Mm-hmm. But the house is nice as well.
So far, so wow.
Oh, yes.
Let's go inside.
Wow.
Come on.
Big wow.
Built of flint, stone and brick, the exterior of this attractive period cottage has been well maintained. And it's retained its character on the inside too.
Right then, mind your heads on the way in. Right, this is not an entertaining kitchen, I know.
No.
What's your first impression?
It's a decent space.
I like the low ceilings. Sort of feels cosy.
Do you like it?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
You changed the kitchen.
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm.
To what kind of kitchen do you think?
Well, more farmhousey, wouldn't we? Yeah. And range, obviously, back in there. And we'd just try and make it as rustic looking as possible, so.
Take this house back to the mid 19th century.
Yeah. Mm, definitely.
Let me show you the other reception rooms. Okay. Follow me.
Oh, look at this. Mmm. Nice-sized dining room. Mm.
So a bit more space in here.
Yeah, but still very cosy.
Mm.
Still got a very cottagey feeling to it.
It does.
Original features again, nooks and crannies everywhere.
Yeah.
I really like it. Yeah, it's cosy, it's a bit quirky.
Upstairs, despite some modernisation, the character continues in 3 cosy double bedrooms which share the use of a large family bathroom. And there's yet more living accommodation to explore, access from outside the back of the property, where we find an adjoining annex.
Now then, this is let out separately. It gets between £280 and £380 per week throughout the season. Tick.
Oh, my gosh!
So let's see where your paying guests or freeloaders might go to bed. Come with me. Come on.
That's just the reaction I was hoping for. As well as a fully fitted kitchen, the annex has a utility area to the back and upstairs a good-sized shower room and double bedroom.
So this is essentially a completely self-contained one-bedroom cottage.
Fantastic. Mm. You have made dreams come true.
Well, wow. This then makes the house a four-bedroom house.
Yeah.
Mm. It's not our taste at all, but it doesn't matter because we can completely see, you know, what we would look to do. Put a bit of, you know, character back into this.
And you'd have fun doing that, wouldn't you?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Now, the main thing for you was outside space.
Yeah.
Let's go and have a look at the garden, then. Let me just squeeze past you. Thank you very much.
As if the annex wasn't enough, there's further potential for development outside, with two garages and a separate workshop, meaning no shortage of places for Luke and Charlotte's bar, all surrounded by very impressive manicured gardens.
So, colourful, isn't it?
Absolutely beautiful.
Yeah, it's quite frightening seeing the amount of stuff we would have to be doing out here, but it's beautiful. I mean, it's amazing.
It's a credit to the owners,
so
isn't
nice.
It?
Yeah. Yeah.
See that brick wall there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is the formal boundary.
Okay.
Beyond there is council-owned allotments.
Right, cool.
Solely rented by the owners of this house. At the moment, they pay something like £40 a year. That is expected to go up. But if it's a couple of hundred pounds a year, you'd be mad to let that go. So how much do you think you'd have to spend on this?
I think it's probably about £400,000, I'd say.
OK.
I think slightly over that, £410,000.
This house is on the market for £400,000.
Hey.
Well done. I want you to go and have a look in the rest of the property. Yeah. I will meet you whenever you're finished. I imagine you could be some time.
I think we will.
Right. See you in a bit.
See ya.
Okay, see you later.
Bang on budget, this character cottage has the three bedrooms Luke and Charlotte need. And with a little cosmetic work, the potential to turn it into a fantastic family home. It comes with a separate one-bedroom annex and a number of outbuildings. It's in a rural spot, just a 10-minute drive from the nearest town.
A lot smaller than I was expecting, but lovely view.
Beautiful views.
Yeah.
But I guess that's the price you pay for having the annex right on the building. You know, it's not that big, really, is it?
Yeah. Just a lot more work needs doing than I'd previously anticipated. When I first walked up to the house, I thought it looked absolutely amazing. It's just the kind of house that I imagine living in from the outside. It's just beautiful.
I quite like the quirkiness of the size of the rooms, the low ceilings. It did feel a little cramped, I guess.
I think it would definitely be a lifetime project. However, it's somewhere we could live in the meantime whilst we, you know, did it up, definitely.
Right then, all done and dusted. That's two houses in one day.
Yes.
Did you enjoy them?
Really enjoyed it, yes.
Hopefully give you something to think about tonight, and then tomorrow it's the mystery house.
Yes,
let's go.
Thanks.
I'm in Norfolk with Luke and Charlotte from South East London, who, with a budget of £400,000, are looking for a family home in the country. So far, as predicted, our buyers have had some passionate reactions to the properties I've shown them. But still to come, our search goes from strength to strength at our mystery house.
Oh, my goodness! You honestly have outdone yourself this time.
And as our property hunt draws to a close, I take the reins on a ride into the past.
OK, so I'm getting up the driver's side now, am I?
That's it.
This bodes well. It sounds like I'm going to be getting action soon. Well, I don't think either of the properties yesterday hit the nail on the head for Luke or Charlotte, which means the pressure is well and truly on today's mystery house. Now, one thing they both told me was that they were almost adamant they had to have a detached house. That is the big compromise, which could mean we fall at the first fence. But if this mystery property's Georgian facade impresses them as much as I hope it might, well, we might just be on to a winner.
For our final mystery offering, I'm taking Luke and Charlotte to North Lopham. This leafy village was once famed for its linen industry, which flourished from the 16th century and was so well regarded in Victorian times that local Thomas Buckenham even held a royal warrant to supply linen to the palace. The village has its own post office, a popular pub, and a local school. It's also home to a number of protected and listed buildings, including the Grade 1 listed St Nicholas Church and our mystery house.
Righty-ho, Charlotte and Luke, the mystery house. I give you this.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, yep. This is definitely a good entrance.
It's the main road going through the village.
Yeah.
It is what it is. Mm-hmm. Are you bothered?
No, I don't think so. Love the look of the house.
But the compromise is, of course, the fact that it's attached. Yeah. Essentially, in mid-terraced, really. Yeah. Yeah. Can you get your head around it?
We can get our head around it.
Good. Let's go through.
Wonderful. Okay.
This impressive Georgian property was built around 1750 and is Grade 2 listed. With the main mystery compromise dealt with before we've reached the front door, I can't wait to see their reaction to the interior.
Oh. Come on, look at this.
This wow, look at that fireplace.
Lovely. This is the epitome of cosy cottage chic, really, isn't it?
But you get those Georgian proportions, don't
you? Yeah. And the flooring is amazing. It's absolutely lovely. I'm gobsmacked.
Good.
And do you know what? We always like the idea of a separate dining room, but I kind of like the idea that, you know, you can all be in this room together, don't you?
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, a little bit more communal.
Yeah. Mm.
There might be an option to have a separate dining room later on in the house. You never know. Let me show you where you'd cook first. Come with me.
OK, lovely.
OK, so, we did say right at the start of this, you like the idea of a big kitchen. You spend all your time in a big kitchen. So this is also one of the compromises. Mm-hmm. You've got the big living dining room as opposed to this being the big kitchen. Are you OK with that?
Yeah, I don't think this looks like a small kitchen.
No.
It's smaller than I had anticipated, and maybe the layout isn't what I'd have wanted, but, you know, it's still a decent size.
Yeah, it's workable, isn't it?
Yeah, it's completely workable.
Let me show you upstairs. Come with me.
The fact they'd be willing to work with this space is a good sign, as it shows they love other aspects of the house enough to make compromises. Hopefully upstairs won't disappoint either. There are the three bedrooms they asked for, two of which are to the front of the house and benefit from high ceilings and sash windows, as well as a family bathroom with separate shower.
OK, so, as it stands, this is your master bedroom.
Lovely. King-size bed, so that's good.
Nice big bed.
Loads of storage space there. Yeah. There's also a bit of a walk-in cupboard at the side of that bed as well.
Yeah.
That's good.
Luke, what's your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, we spend most of our time downstairs.
Yes.
So as long as we've got enough room for a nice big bed, nice big comfy bed, then I'm not too bothered, really.
Before we go out to the garden, I have one more thing to show you. Come with me.
Ooh.
The footprint of the mystery house extends even further to the back, where there's another living room, or snug, which I think could make a great dining or entertaining space, above which is yet another bedroom. This building was originally separate from the main property, but is now connected by a garden room built by the current owners.
So, in this part of the property, you have even more.
Oh, my word.
So, Christmas lunch might be in here.
Yes.
Lovely old
floor. Lovely stone floor, yeah. Now, upstairs, you've got double bedroom. You've got a shower and loo in there. You've got a door here, completely self-contained. So you've got your four bedrooms if you want.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah, not bad, is it?
You honestly have outdone yourself this time. I love it, I absolutely love it.
You are well enough, aren't you? Good for you. Well, the garden will blow you away, so I'm expecting more waterworks. Come on, mate.
Oh my goodness! I don't think I can cope.
At just under a third of an acre, the garden comes with an established vegetable plot and backs on to open farmland. It's the perfect place for their daughter to play in.
So what about this for a garden?
Breathtaking.
It's brilliant.
This is just the house we can grow with, you know, and that's what we're looking for, the house that we can just sort of see us, you know, sort of moving throughout our life in. It's beautiful.
It's perfect, really.
The only thing now is you've got to buy it or afford it. So how much do you think this mystery house is on the market for?
I'm going to say it's out of our budget, and I will probably say about £425,000.
OK.
I'm going to say £415,000.
Right, OK. Decent guesses. This mystery house is on the market for £385,000.
Oh, my goodness!
go back into the house.
Yeah.
Have a good look around.
Yeah.
And I'll meet you whenever you're done.
Thanks ever so much.
All right.
Thanks. See you later.
Enjoy.
Bye.
£15,000 under budget, this magnificent mystery terraced house is the character property Charlotte and Luke have been dreaming of, with room for the family to grow. It has four bedrooms, versatile living areas, and the gardens of just under a third of an acre enjoy views of surrounding countryside.
I wasn't expecting this at all. This little extra piece.
Honestly, I thought what we'd seen was it, but I'm gobsmacked. I can't believe it.
So my initial thoughts were that it looks great from the front, beautiful looking house, not detached, but still a lovely looking property. And then gradually working my way through, I just thought this gets better and better, and now I love it.
Literally, it was like a Pandora's box unravelling as you walked through and saw more and more things. And to see this garden that's absolutely enormous is just the icing on the cake.
Well, what a mystery house that was.
Have
you fallen harder and deeper in love with this place?
As hard and deep as humanly possible.
Well, time now to get yourselves away from this house, have a bit of a quiet time, talk things through, and then we'll meet up and chat, yeah?
OK, wonderful.
Let's go.
Cheers, thank you.
Norfolk is synonymous with rolling fields and farmland, and is one of the few counties in England without a motorway, adding to the peace and tranquility that draws buyers to the county. However, it also means that journeys in and out of the region can take some time. Never was that more true than in the past. In Victorian times, a coach journey from London to Norwich would have taken the best part of a day. But one man championing this form of slow transport is John Parker, a carriage driver from Wingfield. In 1996, he travelled the 139 miles from Norwich to London, setting the world record for a single coachman with a time of 21 and a half hours. And it was in this Royal Mail carriage, dating back to the mid-1800s, that he did it. Well, this is a glorious specimen, isn't it, John? Look at her. 100 or so years ago and beyond, mail was the most important thing, wasn't it?
Well, from 1784.
Yeah.
The first mail coach ran Bristol to London.
OK.
It was a test run, and then they spread out through the region.
The introduction of the first mail coaches in the late 1700s more than halved the post office's previous journey times, and routes were quickly implemented across the UK. Responsible for transporting money and valuables, the carriages had right-of-way on all roads. So important were they that drivers would be fined 1 pence a minute, roughly the equivalent of half a day's pay, for every minute they were late. And if you were responsible for slowing the carriage down, you'd face a prison sentence. If you'd have seen this carting through the countryside, this would be quite something to behold, wouldn't it? You'd have, first of all, a team of horses. How many horses?
Four.
Four horses.
Yeah.
And they weren't just plodding along, were they?
No, they average 8 miles an hour.
An average of 8 miles an hour?
Yeah.
With all of its stops,
yeah.
With changing the teams?
Yeah. They had checkpoints on the way up where they, you know, had to stop. Not only change passengers, because you had to stop every time you want a new team of horses.
This history comes to present day, doesn't it? You teach people to drive teams of horses, don't you?
Yeah. People who've never touched a horse. Right up to people who want to do competitions with teams.
Well, I fancy myself as a bit
and
of a driver.
Army. You do?
Yeah.
Well, we'll have a go then.
Come on then. Back in the late 18th and 19th centuries, drivers were accompanied by a Royal Mail Guard, and carriages like this one would have taken up to 9 passengers on top and 4 inside, which was a bit of a squeeze to say the least. Today, John's taken me out on one of his training carriages, but thankfully, there were just 3 of us. John, myself, and Carol the groom. OK, so I'm getting up the driver's side now, am I?
That's it.
This bodes well. It sounds like I'm going to be getting action soon.
So that will turn you right, that left, pressure on them and quiet voice and you'll...
Ooh, like that, yeah.
And that will say, slow down, stop. That's all it needs. They go on your voice and your hands.
Walk on, then. Walk on.
Keep heading for the fence until you get them into the road. Now, left rein, bring them round. Leave them up.
John has over 50 years' experience at the reins as a coachman in the army, a stunt driver in films, and he's even driven the royal family. So I've definitely come to the right teacher.
Now, I should get up there a bit further. Now, pick up the right rein.
Yep.
Release the left one. Do it yourself. Go on, you can do it. Now, when you're back nearly to the road, bring your left one back, let your right one go. There you are. You've done it yourself. I didn't do it.
That's fantastic. What royals have you had on board?
Princess Anne, Prince Charles, Prince Andrew.
Goodness me.
Prince Philip.
Prince Philip as well?
Yeah. He can drive.
Can he?
Well, I hope I last as long as him and they're capable of driving now, because that's what he does.
I'm not sure I'm ready to drive royalty just yet, but I've certainly enjoyed my test drive. Time now to get up to speed with our house search.
Well, I'm pretty sure that the mystery house is the firm favourite. And now the emotions have hopefully calmed down a bit, let's find out what Luke and Charlotte plan to do. OK, I've got to ask, it almost seems silly doing so. What's your favourite house?
The Mystery House, yeah. Of course.
Heads and shoulders above everything you've seen.
Absolutely.
Full stop ever in our lifetime, I think.
What are you going to do about it? What's next?
So we've got to do some sums, chat to the vendor and hopefully get the ball rolling.
Yeah, and get our property sold, which is kind of the key thing at the
moment. That's the big one, yeah.
That's the thing holding you back at the moment.
Exactly.
I imagine you'd like to put an offer in.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
So there's a bit of pressure on you now.
We can cope with the pressure. Luckily, we have quite a bit of wiggle room with our house, and I think it would be really heartbreaking if we saw something that we could just afford and we weren't in a position where we'd sold our property. So, you know, we're prepared to reduce the price if we need to. We'll just do whatever it takes, I think. This is just... It is the most perfect conclusion, the most perfect end to a wonderful week, and I hoped for it, but I didn't actually think that we would see this property. Yeah.
Well, you have done. Best of luck with the sale, and then, obviously, best of luck with the purchase of the Mystery House. Congratulations.
Thank you very
much.
Thank
you.
You know, I reckon there'll be a few buyers out there in the market at the moment that would have completely dismissed the mystery property because it wasn't detached. But because Luke and Charlotte were able to set aside that initial compromise, they crossed the threshold of that property and were rewarded with a house that just kept on giving. And you saw it yourself. It reduced Charlotte to tears. Now they need to get back to London and get their home sold. And in doing so, they'll be taking a huge step forward to starting a new life up here in Norfolk. Wish all of them the very best of luck.
If you'd like to escape to the country in England, Wales, Scotland or Northern Ireland and would like our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.